right, good morning, guys. As you can tell, it's a little snowy today and kind of chilly, but you know, you dress for the weather. Anyways, I just thought I'd shoot a quick video here to introduce the video. We're going to be talking on Revelation chapter 20 again. This is Tuesday, November 15th, I think. Anyways, a lot of snow, so I'm going to stand right out here, and that's where I'm going to be at for a few hours, and then we'll see what happens after that. All right, so let me set this down and get our camera gear set up and do the sermon, and we'll see what happens after that. All right, love you guys. See you in a few moments. Good afternoon, good morning, good evening, greetings, salutations, and all that. Hello. Welcome to the channel. Welcome to Boulder. Welcome to the second snow here in Boulder, Colorado. It's about, what time? What cold? Let's see, it's about, what, 32 degrees. It was about 16, 18 degrees earlier this morning. Woke up to about 2.5 inches of snow, and it'll be snowing later tonight or tomorrow and all day Thursday. And Friday, we're going to be up there in the mountains, 8,300 feet, probably in the snow too. Who knows, right? So we come out and preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. Long as there's people out here, we're going to do that. As long as we're physically able to. If I'm not physically able, well, that's another story. But if there was not a soul out here, not one single soul, then maybe I could stay home. But I'm not going to stay home. I'm going to preach the gospel to the day Jesus brings me home, the other home, not this home, but that home up above in heaven. So let's pray. Lord, I thank you that we are all called to serve you as ministers of reconciliation. We thank you, Lord Jesus, that your body is a thriving, living body, representing your service in the earth. We are all ambassadors for you, Lord Jesus. And we thank you, Lord, that we can preach the gospel, the word of God, to people. And I thank you, Holy Spirit, that you give us power to preach, power to minister, power to lay hands on the sick for them to recover, power to cast out devils, power to prophesy and to preach the word of God with authority, Lord. And I thank you, Holy Spirit, for giving us what we need to do whatever it is that the Lord Jesus Christ is asking us to do and leading us to do by you, Holy Spirit. In your name, Jesus, and we glorify you, Father. We got to leave you out, man. We love you, Father. Abba, Father, we love you. In your name, Jesus, amen and amen. All right, so our teaching this week is in Revelation chapter 20. My rubber band here keeps my Bible together. Got a new one coming for next year, 2023. This one's been beat up, tore up, spit on, kicked around, pages torn out. It has been everywhere since 2019. This is my preaching Bible, my street Bible, and it has been falling apart. I've got it all taped together in lots of different locations, and I've been praying about a new Bible to refresh, to stay fresh and stay new, not stay all beat up and tore up, but stay fresh and new looking. And so this year, the Lord says, I want you to buy a new Bible. I said, yes, sir. I obey my boss. He signs my paycheck. So he gives you great benefits when you go to work for him. So hallelujah for that. So in our teaching of this Revelation, one chapter per week, we start each sermon, each message for each day in Malachi, which is the last book of the Old Testament, and we go to the last chapter. There's only four chapters, but we go to the last chapter, chapter 4, And we read those six verses that are in chapter 4 of Malachi. And Malachi is kind of a famous book when preachers began talking on tithes and offerings. Malachi chapter 3, 8, 9, 10, right around through there, it says, you have robbed me, even though, you know, you've robbed me. And people said, well, how have we robbed you? Well, in tithes and offerings. And that's what people are doing today. Now, we're not under that law of tithing anymore. But a lot of people still preach on that law, and that's not correct. We don't just give 10% anymore. Not after the resurrection of Jesus Christ and the ascension of Jesus back to heaven. Nowadays, we don't give 10%, we give 100%. 100%. Huh. How many of us are giving 100% to God? That's where we are. That's the era that we're living in. And so people even get mad when you talk about a tenth, 10%. Can't you give 10%? You know, or 1%? People don't even give a dime. They just want to keep it all for themselves. They're so scared of not having enough money or resources or food or clothing or whatever you want to give away. So that's what Malachi is famous for, okay? And we need to be givers. You know, Luke 6:38 says, give. Doesn't say take. It says give, and it shall be given unto you, pressed down, shaken together, and running over, shall men give it unto your bosom. For the same measure that you use, now I'm going to paraphrase, but the same way that you do it, the same measuring, the same system, the same protocol that you give is how it's going to come back to you. If you give freely and abundantly and cheerfully, guess what? People are going to give freely and cheerfully and abundantly back to you. However, if you be stingy and you kind of dole it out a little bit, well, I'm going to give that much, you know. So that's how people are going to get back to you. They're going to be stingy towards you. But I thank God that for years and years and decades, I have freely been a giver. That's why I have not had any needs since 1989. Summer of 89, my whole life changed financially. Not because I got a better job. Not because I got a new business. I was in the trucking business at that time, owned my own tractor and trailer. Not because of that. Not because of any worldly work that I was doing. So how did my finances change so dramatically that it literally put us in a home and a boat? I mean, our whole life, we had money that, and I tell you, since summer of 89, there's not been any lack in my life. Now that's a long time ago. That wasn't just a day or two ago. That was 1989. That was starting in May, June, probably around June of 89, I'm gonna guess. Could have been May, could have been June, could have been July, somewhere in there. My whole life changed. And I only did one thing that made my life change. Can you guess what it is? I became a tither and a giver. Yeah, how about that? Isn't that novel? You know, I entered into God's kingdom finances. I entered into God's covenant with those givers. God says, I will not be mocked. Whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. But how you sow is how you'll reap. Right? Paul talked about that. You be a cheerful giver. You know, it doesn't matter how much you give. Paul talked about it's not the amount. A lot of people are so bent on the amount. And the reason they're bent and they're so key on the amount is because of their pride. That's it. I tell you, God honors a dollar just like he honors $1,000. God honors a penny like he honors $10,000. We know that. I don't even have to preach on that. Everybody who's a Christian who reads their Bible already knows all this stuff. I don't even know why I got to bring it up. It wasn't even in my thinking today. I don't think. Could have been. I don't know. Actually, I'm always giving. Like yesterday, I was over there at Conestoga and Arapaho, and sometimes when I reach in my pocket, I got my gospel tracts here, I got a dozen gospel tracts here and a dozen in my back pocket. I also have 10 church cards, and in the church, between the church cards, I have three $4 packs. And then I give two gospel tracts and the $4 to those who have a need. I donate to them. So I pulled that out yesterday to donate to this gentleman, and we were talking, and I saw a need, So, you know, that's enough to buy a bus ticket, a couple hot dogs or a couple hamburgers, or to get out of the cold and go to McDonald's and have some coffee. It's enough to do something, okay? And I asked them on the street, is this enough? Should I increase it? And everyone I've talked to, because I used to do $2 and $3 and now $4. You don't want to give too much to the guys on the street. You just want to give enough, but not too much. So what is that? Well, I asked them. I don't guess what they need. I asked, is this enough? And everyone I've talked to said, yes, this is enough. All right, praise God. So anyways, so I pulled that out and $2 got stuck in the packet and it only came two. And he looked at that. And I looked at it going, that doesn't look right. Now I could have said, oh, that's okay. You know, that's okay. I said, no, wait a minute. That's not right. And I went back in my little pack. Oh man, it's stuck to this other track here. So I pulled that other $2 out and made sure he had the amount that I give, okay? And he was well pleased. Now what they do with the money, it's their deal, not mine. Quit controlling how you give. You give to God, you don't give to people. A lot of people get that all messed up in their brain. You give to God, and God tells you, I want you to give to that person. Now that's between them and God, not between you. You're not in the mix. You're just a vessel that God is using to give to that person. Because I've been told so many times, I can't even count. Well, I don't want to give to them because they'll buy alcohol, they'll buy drugs, they'll buy cigarettes. Look, it's none of your business what they do with the money. It's God's business, not yours. Quit controlling God. Anyways, enough of that. I don't like talking about money or giving because it ruffles people's feathers too much, especially now that in America or probably around the world, we're going into this so-called pseudo, made-up, created recession. God is not in recession. Heaven's not in recession. There's no lack in heaven, there's no lack in God's kingdom, you know, but, you know, I don't understand that, but that's okay, you know. God provides. You don't provide. God provides, if you're a believer. Now, if you're not a believer, you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, well then, take care of that. Because what is coming down the road, what is coming down one day, is going to devastate your life. It's going to destroy it. It's going to be so horrible. And you won't be ready for it. And your children won't be ready for it. Your family won't be ready for it. Because you don't believe it. But if you wait till the storm hits, you won't be ready. There's no way you're going to be able to get ready for the storm when you're in the storm. It won't happen. You're going to sink in the storm. You know, I'm Navy. I've been on boats all most of my life. You know, you get ready for the storm and the waves before the storm and the waves come. You don't get ready when you're in the storm. You know, you bolt down the hatches, you know, you pull in all the stuff and you get things ready for the storm because you know the storm's coming. Well, that's what we do. Get ready. The storm is coming. The storm's coming. So what am I doing as a preacher? I'm getting ready for the storm. I've been getting ready for the storm for decades. Just because it has showed up doesn't mean anything to me. I don't care. I'm ready now. Let the storm hit. But I rebuke it in the name of Jesus. All right. So let's get into Malachi, then we'll go into that. So that's something I had to talk about, I guess. You know, I didn't know I was going to do that. But maybe it's for someone out there. Who knows? Who knows, right? Who does know? God. God knows. God is real. Yesterday and the day before, or just about every day, not every day, but just about every day, I get somebody yell at me, God's not real. That's what I hear on the street. I never heard that 30 years ago. I never heard that God isn't real. But that's what's going on today. So people are programming themselves, God's not real, God's not real, God's not real. Well, so to them, God's not real. But to me, and to believers like you, God's real. And He shows Himself all the time. And since I brought that up, I want to make sure that we are praying for everyone that we know. Always keep people that you know in prayer and supplication. Supplication is a petition before the Lord. And because sometimes people get sick, people get ill, the devil attacks. And when we're already praying for the person, the family, or whatever the case may be, the ministry, we're already in that, you know, that movement, that way. And it's just, it's not much effort to kind of increase it a little bit. So just be alert to always be praying for people that are in your life, okay? So Malachi chapter 4, verse 1. For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yea, and all that do wickedly shall be stubble. Man, oh man. And the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, that I shall leave them neither root nor branch. But unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings. Hallelujah, right? Healing. And you shall go forth and grow up as calves of the stall. Verse 3. You shall tread down the wicked, for they shall be ashes under the soles of your feet in the day that I shall do this, saith the Lord of hosts. Verse 4. Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded unto him in Horeb, for all Israel, with the statutes and judgments. 5. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet for the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the heart of the fathers to the children, and the heart of the children to their fathers, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse. Wow. I tell you, that's serious business. But it's interesting. I hope you find it interesting. I think it's fascinating. I love it, man. I've been getting a lot out of it. All right. Revelation chapter 20 in the King James Bible. Verse 1. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit, and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and bound him 1,000 years. Verse 3. And cast him into the bottomless pit, and shut him up, and set a seal upon him, that he should deceive the nations no more, till 1,000 years should be fulfilled. And after that, he must be loosed a little season. Verse 4. And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. I'm going to stop right there. So the reason I stopped is because I was quickened. That's what the King James calls it. Your spirit is moved by the Spirit of God. And when you begin to recognize that movement inside of you, you'll know that that's the Spirit of God moving. But if you've been ignoring the Spirit of God, if you've been rejecting the Spirit of God, if you don't believe in the move of the Spirit of God, then you won't feel, you won't sense, you won't pick up that quickening of the Spirit. So to fix that, you repent. Lord, I repent. I turn away from hardening my heart towards your Spirit. Or whatever. You know, you pray and you ask for help. And he sets you free. He cleans you up. He does. And he, you know, and then the moment the Holy Spirit talks to you, and then do something. Just don't pray and do like you've been doing. Because to repent means to not do what you've been doing. I don't know why people think, I repent, but then you go and do it all over again. A little problem in the intersection there. It looks like it's going to work out, I hope. Anyways, I'm outside. This isn't a green screen. I'm out here in the public. Very busy intersection, 28th and Arapahoe. 28th here and Arapahoe here. God bless you, man. All right, so praise God. Sorry. Too bad I didn't have a 360 degree camera. You can kind of see what's going on, but it only goes one way, you know. But God bless you, man. All right, so let's go back in here again. All right, so anyways, I was talking about quickening of the spirit, so I hope you understand that. God bless you. That's what I do. I say God bless them to people. I just don't ignore anybody. I don't ignore a soul. My prayer, my petition before the Lord is, Lord, I don't want to miss any soul. I don't want to miss one single soul out here. Every soul to me, Preacher John, is critically important to me. And so when I'm on my watch, the hours that I'm out here on the street, I am fully into praying and believing, standing in the gap before the Lord for every single soul. I don't care what they do, what they act, I believe God, as long as they're not dead. Because once they die, that's it. I don't pray for them anymore. People die every day. It's a part of life, right? Part of life. Somebody's born, somebody dies. All right, so let's go back in here. So what I'm gonna do is we're gonna do on four, looks like. I did one on Sunday. I did two and three over there in Conestoga and Arapaho on Monday. So here, 28th in Arapaho on Tuesday, we're gonna do verse four. There's only 15 verses, so we got plenty of time here. It looks like I'll be preaching every day this week, so I'm pretty excited about that. We may have a little bit of a problem tomorrow, because I have an eye appointment tomorrow, and I just found out an hour ago that what they're gonna do to me, I may not be able to see for 4 to 6 hours. So I don't know what I'm gonna do there yet. The appointment's at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. That was the earliest I can get in. So we'll see what happens. I'm at Folsom and Canyon tomorrow. It's only a half a mile from the eye doctor's appointment. All right, so verse four, let me read it one more time and then talk about it. Verse four, chapter 20, Revelation, King James Bible. And I saw thrones, plural, and they sat upon them. And judgment was given unto them, and I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark on their foreheads or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. All right, so let's get into this. Verse 4, and I saw thrones. Remember, in the spirit, John was in the spirit on the Lord's day. He wasn't in the flesh, he was in the spirit. That's why I was talking about being quickened by the Spirit of God. Being stirred by the Spirit of God. Well, different words you can use there. But, yeah, God bless you, thank you. A lot of mockers, God bless you. So, in the spirit, you have eyes to see. In the spirit, you have ears to hear. In the spirit, you have a heart to understand what's going on. You have mobility. You can do things. You can live in the spirit. And John has actually proven to all of us right now that even now, while we're living on earth, we can be living in the spirit, because he's doing it right here. He's given us an example, 22 chapters of living in the spirit. How long did it take to write 22 chapters? How long was the vision? How long did it take to see all this? How long? We don't know. Was it 10 minutes? 10 days? 10 years? I don't know, you know. But it was a timeline of some sort. So he was living in the spirit during that timeline of seeing what was the Lord was showing him, all the activity, and then writing all this. Did he write this in the spirit? I'm going to say yes. I'm going to say he wrote Revelation in the Spirit. That's why Revelation is so important. But that's also why Satan doesn't like the book of Revelation. He doesn't like it. He hates it. It's his number one book he hates the most. But how do I know that? How could I say that? Well, you do. You go to the Bible and you find the answer. The answer is, Jesus said, you know them by their fruit. Okay, there's the verse. How do we know that Satan hates this book more than any other book? Because that's the one major book that Satan is trying to get out of the Bible. He is convincing theologians that the book of Revelation is not a holy book or a doctrine of Christ or whatever they're saying. I don't know exactly, but they're trying to get revelation out of the Bible. Yeah. So when they're going to do that? I don't know. Might be tomorrow. I don't know. You know, next year? I don't know. But that's what they're doing. So now I know that Satan doesn't like this book the most. So now also another point that I know is because many Christians do not read Revelation. You start asking everybody, start asking all the people you know who are believers, when's the last time you read the book of Revelation? Have you read all 22 chapters? Really? Okay. I mean, you know, and find out what they say. It'll be interesting, right? It might surprise you. Maybe in your circle of friends and associates, many people have read Revelation. Well, man, you're in a good company. But if you're in a company of believers who say, well, no, I've never read Revelation, or I don't know how many chapters in Revelation, well, I don't know anything about it, I don't like it. Well, then that company is a company you need to leave after you preach to them. After you preach to them, leave and go find another company of believers who read Revelation, who know about it, right? So that's what you want to do. God bless you, man. God rules a little bit. What's that? Yeah. Enjoy. Guy pulls over, rolls his window down. You have a YouTube channel? Reach in my pocket. So I wrote it on my gospel tracks. Amen, right? Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. So let's get back into 4 here. And I saw thrones. I think it's really interesting. He used the word thrones, plural. He didn't say the throne of God. So he's not talking about the throne of the Lamb of God. He's talking about other thrones. How do we know that? By the rest of this verse. Watch this, thrones, so it's plural. So when you see the plural thrones, what's the first thing you should know? You should see in your mind, your spirit, the 24 thrones around about the throne of the Lamb of God, right? Roundabout. So roundabout means round, I guess. It says roundabout. So when, like I was in Trinidad, I was preaching at the roundabout. You know, a little circle that people drive into the roundabout and they go out the other side, you know? So that would be kind of like in Trinidad, that's where that horse was that I took a picture of, that big old metal horse that was sitting in the middle of the roundabout. I think that's pretty symbolic. Anyways, roundabout. So the 24 thrones round about the Lamb of God, right? Okay, and here's the, and I saw thrones, plural, and they, plural, so we know it's talking about plurals, confirming that thrones is plural, and they sat upon them, them being plural. So now we have 1, 2, 3 confirmations that the thrones means plural. You get that? Wow, how about that? But if you read that really fast and you just breeze through it and you read it like a novel, you wouldn't see that. You wouldn't see the confirmation, the word confirming the word, that thrones, plural with an S, is correct because it had other plural words pointing back to that plural word, plural being many, right? More than one, right? Plural meaning more than one. And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them. They sat upon them. So that goes back to those 24 elders that sat upon the 24 thrones, right? That would cast their crown down and fall down and worship the Lamb of God, right? See, it all goes together if you just read it like a wonderful literature, slowly, deliberately, with power and authority with the Holy Ghost. Good things happen. When you follow, when you're in the Spirit of God, good things happen. That's why I like what Oral Roberts used to say. People would get mad at Oral Roberts when he would say, something good is going to happen to you. I loved it, man. I said, yes, something good is going to happen to me, man. Hallelujah. I receive it, Lord. Something good is going to happen to you. I mean, I should say that myself from now on. I love that, man. I don't hear anybody say that anymore. When Oral died, here a few years ago, that was the last time. I think he lasted until he's 94. I think he died at 94. I think so. Billy Graham was 99. I'll be in my 90s too. If the Lord tarried. But if he doesn't tarry and comes back today, I'm ready, right now. Come, Lord Jesus. I'm ready. I hope you're ready. Verse 4, and I saw thrones that sat, and they that sat upon them. And judgment was given unto them. There's another confirmation. Them. Judgment was given unto them. So, I think that's interesting that the Lamb of God didn't do the judging in this particular little piece of scripture here. It was the elders who sat upon the thrones. God gave them power to make judgment. You know? It's really important to understand that. So there's a time to judge, and there's a time not to judge. Or whatever. Right? So stop judging people. I don't judge anybody. You know, I rebuke them, yeah. And I tell them the truth and all that kind of stuff. But, I'm never accused of judging people. I don't think I've been told three times in 3 years, or four or five, this is 3.5 years. May was 3 years, that I'm judging them. I don't think I've been three, four times, maybe. I don't know. I just don't get that because I'm not judging them. I'm loving on them. I want them to be saved. But if they need a strong, powerful word, I deliver it. I don't care. It doesn't matter to me. But I operate a little different because I am a pastor to a church and I want people to come by me. I want them to go to church. I was talking to a fellow just an hour ago, 30 minutes ago, and he was talking about our church. God bless you, Stephen. And he was talking about our church. Wow, he knew all about our church. I thought, wow, how about that? He must have mentioned it 3 or 4 times. I didn't say anything to him. I thought, wow, that's kind of interesting. Wow. I was getting my mail for the church. And he's mentioning about our church. Anyways, verse 4, and I saw thrones that sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. Judgment was given. And I saw. So once again, you see that John saw something. And the Holy Spirit allowed him to write it down. Got a little bit of sun coming in there, huh? How about that? It'll go beyond the clouds in just a moment. Kind of messes up the camera a little bit. Maybe I should turn this around. I don't know. Doing these videos is not easy. It's not something that you think it is. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded. Wow. We know that that is part of a Christian's life. Because Jesus talked about it. If you refuse the mark of the beast, you refuse to worship the image of the beast, you refuse to worship the beast, to take his mark, to take his number, to do all that kind of stuff, then it will be given authority to people to arrest you and to, you know, to do this. What this was saying right here. So, be alert. Be alert. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded. So where are these souls at? But if he saw them and he saw the thrones, they must have been in heaven. How about that? The thrones aren't on earth, the thrones are in heaven. Thrones are in heaven. So there, and John said, I saw those people that didn't take the mark of the beast. They were in heaven too, apparently, because that's where the thrones were. All right? And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus. Witness of Jesus. That's what I'm doing. I'm being a witness of Jesus. Jesus saved. My banner says Jesus Christ. All right. A witness of Jesus. And for the word of God, I preach the word of God everywhere I go, just like I handed the tracts to the people in the car just a moment ago. A witness for Jesus. And for the word of God, because I preach the word of God. And which had not worshipped the beast. I won't worship the beast. I'm sorry, I will not do that. I would rather die rather than worship the beast. I won't do that. Sorry. So you better get ready. You better be telling yourself, I won't do that. And practice believing that. Because if you just flip it off, or I won't be around, or I won't, that won't be a problem with me. And you just, God bless you. Thank you so much. And you just flip that off. Lady says, God bless you, and a nice looking Jeep over there. college student, young girl, college student, a fancy brand new Jeep, whatever it's called. She said, God bless you. That's very rare. Very, very rare in Boulder. But there's a lot of Christian students going to see you. There is. Don't be surprised. There is. And there's a lot of preaching going on the campus of CU. God is moving on the CU campus, which is right there. Right on the other side of this building. You see it. It's right there. Right there. All right? So anyways, and I saw the souls of them that were had witness of Jesus for the word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image. So there's the beast. You can worship the beast, or you can worship the image of the beast. And now you have to kind of think about, let's stop for a second, think about that. The beast can only be in one place at a time because he's one devil, okay? So therefore, he's not omnipresent like God. God doesn't need a satellite network. God doesn't need television to reveal himself. That's silly. A lot of preachers back in the 80s were preaching, that's why we have satellites, so God can show himself. Look, that's the work of the devil. The devil needs television. The devil needs a satellite system because he's only one angel. He's not omnipresent. Bless her in Jesus' name. That's wonderful. I mean, she hollered at the top of her lungs, man. God bless you. Thank you. What you're doing. I mean, wow. Anyways, if the beast is over someplace, because God knows where the beast is, that's not a mystery to God, then he uses the satellite network that being put around the world, so every single solitary soul at one time down in the future here will be able to get internet connection. No doubt about it. I don't care if you're deep in the heart of the Amazon jungle, you're going to have internet connection. Maybe not today, but you will. And therefore, every single soul on the whole planet will one day be able to worship the image of the beast. That's why it has image. Because the people in the Amazon jungle, desert, I mean, you know, wilderness there, whatever it is, Amazon, down there in South America, Central America, Central South America, they won't be able to go to wherever the beast is, but those where the beast is, they'll worship the beast. That's why it has image. But God doesn't need the satellite network. Get that out of your brain. Because if you go back and listen to the 1980s preaching, that's what they were preaching on. I remember. I've been doing this a long time, so I know. All right, that's not the case. God doesn't need television. Every time I say that, I have to laugh. The moment I heard that, I started laughing. I thought, you've got to be, I mean, you're a man of God, a woman of God, and that's what you just said? I remember laughing to myself, not to anybody else, because everyone believed it. I didn't believe it the moment I heard that, way back when. I thought, how silly. But it doesn't mean he cannot use it. Don't get that too. Oh, snowplow. Dropped his plow right there, moving that snow. So he can use that too. Don't get the idea that he uses everything. Where's the Bible verse for that? Everything must have a verse in the standard. God bless you, man. Well, that's where when he fed the 5,000, he told the people to pick up all the scraps, all the pieces of bread and all the fish. And that's where they took the two fishes and or the three fish and two loaves or whatever it was, and they brought back to the guy 12 baskets full of bread and fish. Wow, that's law of sowing and reaping, right? People don't get it. They hoard it all. What happens if that little boy, I mean, it wasn't all that, but that lad, whoever it was, who had his lunch, because the disciples said, there's no food anywhere. Send them all back into town. He said, no, don't do that. She said, don't do that. Let's have them sit down, and I'll break the, and, you know, so the lad come forward. So there's got to be some bread. You know, he brought them forward. He broke the bread, blessed it, broke the fish, blessed it, gave it to his disciples, and the disciples fed everybody. And everybody ate till they were full. Full. And then Jesus said, collect all the scraps, collect all the extra. What happens if that boy says, I can't give you my bread and my fish because this is all I have. Let them fend for themselves. He didn't do that. Are you doing that? Oh, this is all I got. This is all I got. I can't give you anything. How about the widow woman who fed Elijah when she was going to fix her last meal for her and her son? This is our last meal, Elijah. You're the man of God. Ask God to bring down bread from heaven. This is my last meal. She didn't say that. But this is my last meal. And then Elijah had so much boldness to say, well, then feed me first. Now, where's that in the Bible? God says, give of the first fruits. Everything's in the Bible. Study the Word of God with this Word of God, with the Spirit of Truth. Study the Spirit of Truth with in the Word of Truth. You know, put it all together. Hallelujah. Let me go back in the verse here. And I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus, for the Word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. So you can see there that not everybody will receive a mark. You know, if you're in the Amazon jungle, do you need a mark on your forehead or your hand to do trading? I don't think so. Now, it could be, but why did God always give you so all these different categories? There's like four different categories. The beast, the image of the beast, the mark, and something else too. I think there are four. There might be three. The beast, the image, the mark. I don't know, maybe there's only three. God bless you, man. Because some people are only going to worship the image. If you're in the Amazon jungle, you don't need any money. you do other things. You do other stuff to eat. But you can, in the Amazon jungle, for example, worship the image. So therefore, you made a mistake. Other places, they need to have a mark. Like in America, you're going to have to take a mark. All of America and probably all of Western civilization will probably have to take the mark on their forehead or their hand, because that's the type of society that we live in. You know, but other societies, they'll worship the beast. They won't take the mark, or they worship the image, but they'll worship the beast himself. Okay, so that's that. And then there's other people who won't. You know, anyways, you see what I'm trying to say? God has everything covered. Nobody's going to be missing. He's got everybody covered. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Oh, God. I am so excited. I hope you're excited, man. I mean, the Word of God and preaching and just being out with people and witnessing, I tell you, it's just the best thing in the world. The greatest job in the world, like that guy said on Sunday. The greatest job in the world. I'm doing the greatest job in the world. Verse 4, and I saw thrones, and they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. And I saw the souls of them that were beheaded for the witness of Jesus and for the Word of God, which had not worshipped the beast, neither his image, neither had received his mark upon their foreheads or in their hands. And they lived and reigned with Christ. They lived. They. He's referring back to those who are in heaven. They, the ones that are in heaven. All right? The ones that are in heaven. Not the ones who are dead in their sin. Not the ones who are worshiping. The ones who are in heaven. All right? Praise God. We got this big bus here. Hope you can make it in here all right. Sometimes they don't know what they're doing, but sometimes they do. Great big old Ace Express coaches. So he was sitting right here. The reason he was sitting there most likely was because there's no snow on his wheel wells, is because I-70 was probably chains only. And so he stayed here last night. That's what it looked like, because there was snow all around his bus. So maybe the chain law just lifted not too long ago. That's what they do. All right? Praise God. God bless you, man. God bless him, man. Neither received their mark, And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. And they lived and reigned with Christ 1,000 years. All right? So now we know that Christ was sitting on the throne, that the 24 elders around the thrones, and there was Christ gave the power to judge to them. Now, what's interesting to me, I'm going to bring something up I thought was interesting. We'll probably read a little later on, but right now we don't have the reading because we're going to stop right there at 4. And that is, I got to put my gloves on. My hands are so frigid cold. Frigid cold, I said. I mean, they're red. We're going to put these on real quick. Sorry, it's just really, really cold. Man. Now, what's getting my attention is that he did not, in this particular verse, so why did Christ give the power or the authority to judge to the elders on the thrones? Was it to judge the people who are in heaven? Not to judge them for their sin, but to judge them for their works they did for Christ while they're on earth, so that Christ could give them their reward. I think that's interesting because it's not really the time for judgment, because the great white throne of judgment, I don't think, is here yet. I don't know. I don't think we've read it yet. I don't think. If we have, I'm sorry if I can't remember. I don't think we have. But there is a time that Jesus Christ, the Lamb of God, is going to judge the dead and it's going to be later on this chapter. I remember that now. But there's a time, it does say the great white throne of judgment, something like that, the great white throne. And that's where the people are going to be judged who are not found written in the book of life. It's going to task hell and death and Satan, the beast, the dragon, the false prophet, all those guys, everybody that's not going to be in heaven, he's going to cast in the lake of fire. Forever and ever and ever, everlasting. All those whose names not written in the book of life. So, but maybe this is where they're going to, I don't know that. It's just really interesting. It'd be interesting to see what's going to go on next, okay? And I might be talking incorrectly. Don't know that. But we'll see, right? So let's pray. Lord, I just thank you that we can preach, we can minister out here in the snow and the cold, and out here, and people know what we're doing. And we praise you, Lord. We give you all the glory, Father, for what you are doing here on this channel, here on the street, in your name, Jesus, we pray. We do, we pray. Thank you, Lord. Hang on a second. God bless you. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. Hallelujah. I was going to say something, but now I don't think I'm going to say that. So that's where I was hesitant for a moment there. I was thinking about my spirit was like, it was as if my spirit was talking to the Holy Spirit, what do I do here? I don't feel the go ahead to say that. So that's what I was doing just now. All right, so tomorrow, so the takeaway is read, when you read the Bible, read it slower. Don't read it so fast. Read it slower and think about every single word that you are reading. And maybe the Holy Spirit will give you some information that you couldn't have gotten if you read it fast, like we normally do. Okay? So that's something to think about. Then tomorrow I'm going to be at Folsom and Canyon. So Canyon is... Folsom is two lights up there, about two big blocks, and then down to the next block over, so kind of like two blocks away. And Canyon is a really important street. It's Highway 119. It actually comes out of Longmont, goes up Canyon, and goes up into Nederland. That's 119. That's where I'll be tomorrow. So thank you for being here, man. I really appreciate you liking the channel, subscribing to the channel, and all that kind of stuff, whatever you're supposed to do. And I thank you for the comments, too. I thank you for the interaction with the video, if you're still here. So I thank you for praying for the street ministry outreach. I thank you for praying for our missionary church And I thank you for just serving Almighty God the way God has told you to serve Him. Because you have a special job to do, and I can't do it. Nobody else can do it. Only you can do that job that God has called you to do. So God bless you, man. I love you very much. Take care. Bye-bye.